Well, the warning signs don't stop there. Shifting now from the housing crisis to the future of U.S. debt, China has begun to rid itself of U.S. bonds and is now investing in Japan's yen and the euro. Joining me to understand the international implications this could have on the U.S. and global economy is investigative journalist Webster Tarpley.
Hello.
Hey there, Webster. Now, tell me, what does this mean, or what does this spell for the future of U.S. debt?
Well, China has between $2.5 trillion and $3 trillion of foreign exchange, and generally they've kept about a third of that in dollars, but this amount has been going down and the proportion going down. So what we have now is the U.S. Treasury tells us that in May the Chinese were holding about 32, 33 billion less of U.S. Treasury paper, Treasury bonds, bills, Treasury securities in general than they had been doing in April. So that's the lowest level of Chinese holdings of U.S. government paper in 1 year. So it means China is diversifying. I wouldn't say dumping, but they're diversifying. We got to also remember in the meantime that the U.S. two-year Treasury note today hit an all-time high price and an all-time low interest rate, meaning that everybody in the world is piling into short-term U.S. Treasury paper because they're so frightened of a depression. And I think that's the, ultimately, that's behind the scenes. We have a world economic depression. The United States economy is in depression, no doubt about it. When you have minus 27% in existing home sales, plus the unemployment data, the foreclosure data you've just been going through, that's a depression. There's no doubt about it.
Well, then, what is China taking precautions then to in diversifying its ability to invest in different economies?
What they're doing is interesting. The U.S. hedge fund universe, right? Soros, Einhorn, Paulson, these people, as we know, had a plan to shift the depression into Europe. They were trying to destroy the euro with a speculative attack on Greece, Spain, Portugal, and so forth. And this was done in a orchestrated fashion.
And how do they do that?
By using credit default swaps, by attacking Greek government bonds, using credit default swaps and other things. Now, the Germans began to fight back. They banned naked credit default swaps. But the interesting thing is the role of China. I think you can make a case now that China made a three-pronged decision that they would not let the euro go down. This was for technical reasons. The Chinese were essentially rebalancing this basket that they used to keep their currency stable, and notice it has not gone up compared to the dollar, so they were buying euros for commercial reasons, and also they made a political decision that they wouldn't let the U.S. destroy the euro. And specifically, they were buying up Greece. We have the Chinese vice prime minister visiting Greece in June, going to Piraeus and signing all sorts of deals, shipping, telecom, containers, all kinds of things. And development projects. We have a very interesting quote from the Greek deputy foreign minister after meeting with his Chinese colleague. He says, "The Chinese wanted a gateway into Europe. They're not like these Wall Street blankety-blanks always pushing investments on paper. The Chinese deal in real things, merchandise, and they will help the real economy in Greece." So tangible physical production. So the Chinese have been buying up Greece at very good prices, right? Very low prices. And the Anglo-Americans are beside themselves because their attack on the euro is not working because the Chinese are supporting the euro by supporting Greece,
Webster,
and these other countries.
I want to ask you how the U.S. is responding to this, if they're worried about the latest moves from China, but also what's happening on a global scale as far as how the world looks at American debt.
Certainly. There's a notice that the demand for Treasury paper is short-term, two-year, 10-year, 20-year, 30-year. It's not so robust. So there's obviously a fear, there's a great desire to keep the dollar as the world reserve currency. If you have a war in the Middle East, everybody will need dollars because the price of oil will go up. So that's one of the things that's impelling some circles to push towards this war involving Iran. The other aspect of it, though, is the forces of depression remain there, right? $1.5 quadrillion of derivatives centered mainly in New York and London. They are going to explode sometime soon. The big question is, where will the first explosion take place? Now, there's something going on with the Hungarian forint in the last couple of days. If Hungary is where the explosion comes, then the euro could indeed go down. That's still a possibility. But it's more likely in New York. If you look at the Bank of America chart over the last couple of months and look at it look at these banks today, you'll see that Bank of America has a very ugly chart. Citibank, there are rumblings about Citibank getting into trouble in September, October. If it turns out to be Bank of America and Citibank, then the dollar will be the one that, that goes down.
Now, I want to also get into what could happen if China decides to stop buying U.S. debt and stop investing in U.S. bonds. What would that spell for our recovery?
There is no recovery. There's a depression. It's not even a double dip. There was no coming up for air. I mean, the economists have gotten this part all wrong. It's the second wave of a world economic depression. I don't see the Chinese dumping the dollar, because that would massively devalue what they do have. However, they have intervened to sort of cross up the U.S.-British strategy vis-a-vis Europe, so they're showing certain signs of economic independence. And remember, Geithner in the whole springtime was saying, we got to get the Chinese currency up, right? We've got to get them to raise the, instead of keeping it at an artificially low level.
And
the Chinese are not doing that.
Why was he trying to get the Chinese to do that?
He's trying to export the depression into China. In other words, the only game in the world right now is beggar my neighbor and dump the depression on somebody else. So they tried to do it with China. The Chinese have kept the renminbi stable. They tried to do it with Europe. That won't work. Sooner or later, something is going to blow. And wherever it blows is going to be the next currency that will go down. And, of course, the dollar and the pound are likely, but the euro is also possible. The yen is at basically an all-time high today. It's at a 15-year high compared to the dollar and a 9-year high compared to the euro. But for the Japanese, this is a terrible thing, because their currency is so high that their exports are being strangled. So this is currency chaos and a world depression. And we would be very good to get back to the Bretton Woods system, the thing that ended 39 years ago, when you had fixed parities and you didn't have this kind of chaos of floating rates.
Well, it seems like power and influence as far as the economy goes is definitely shifting on different realms.
Sure.
That was investigative journalist Webster Tarpley on the latest on China's moves.